Hi friends, so today is 21st September and we are meeting here for the second time at this nice sports complex in DRDO phase 2. Today the agenda is to meet, discuss about the rules and regulations and some part of the syllabus and just have an eyeball. So my name is Bharat and call sign is Victor Uniform 2 November Foxtrot Kilo. And this is Mr. Yogesh who has been helping with all the activities so far and he's been very helpful. So would you like to say hi?
Hi everyone.
So we'll keep you updated. On time now is 8:50. The event is supposed to start at 9 o'clock. We have 10 more minutes to go. Can't see a single soul other than the two of us. Hope they come on time. So sir, what are you looking forward for today in the event?
Good morning friends, I am Yogesh Prabhu. I am here today to discuss about the rules and regulations of WPC to become a ham. So looking forward for an interesting discussion today.
Yes, and I hope it's going to be interesting. People have started coming in slowly. Probably in another 10 minutes we'll have more people. Ham radio is not just about radio, it's about incorporating radio in your other experiences, other hobbies. So as much as possible, let's try to do that. We'll get more friends here, so we can just connect. Hi. Thank you all for the introductions. What we'll start off now is, I hope you're all aware that we are all answering the restricted grade of license. So I'll just start off with the introduction of the license schemes and things like that, and then slowly we'll get into the rules and regulations part. So in ham radio is a hobby in which we are experimenting with radios, as we all know by now. And it is not only about talking with radio, but using radio in your day-to-day activities also is what it trains us in. So in India we have two grades of licenses. One is called the restricted grade of license and the second is called the general grade of license. So the restricted grade of license gives you lesser power levels and lesser modes to operate on by default, and the general grade of license gives you a little higher power levels, probably 2 to 4 times of increased power levels, and it also gives you more modes to operate on. In order to get the radio licenses, you need to answer a test. It's called Amateur Station Operator Certificate, ASOC, and it's conducted by the WPC, the Department of Telecoms wing. So the test is like whenever you use a shared resource, you always need to answer a test. For example, when you're using a road or something, you're giving a driving test so that you don't cause inconvenience to others. So same way, the ham radio frequencies are like a shared resource. Unlike a commercial radio station where every station is allocated one frequency, here it's not like that. Here you get a bunch of frequencies in a very large band of operations. We'll talk about the restricted grade, and that's the grade that we are answering currently. I mean, that's what we are trying to prepare, most of us. A few of us are not. A few of us are also trying to answer the general grade. So the general grade requires the Morse code training. So that's the reason that we are trying not to do the general grade in the first attempt. So coming to today's discussion is only on rules and regulations, and the flow of the presentation today will be, initially we will discuss about initially we are actually starting off with discussing the syllabus for the rules and regulations. We'll go in depth and we'll try to understand why such a syllabus is set. And after that, we will go into little bit of basics on few of the topics of the rules and regulations. And finally, the main aim today is to learn how to communicate. So we'll start off with the general amateur calling procedures. So we have all installed this Zello app on your mobiles, so we can use it for training ourselves and using it. So as soon as you get a handheld, generally people take some time to get on the air because they are nervous and they don't know how to speak. So once you start using the Zello app and we start communicating in similar lines, we might be more confident. So as soon as you get the license, you might be ready to get onto the air. So our final goal is towards moving to that point where we are able to communicate with each other. what this act tells is, it governs every kind of telegraph. Telegraph is not just the old telegraph which was being sent, telegrams being sent, but any kind of a message communication between two parties is called telegraph. So the Indian Telegraph Act basically controls how the communication should happen, like whether the government is allowed to spy on you, or is allowed to listen to you, under what situation they can listen on to you, and what happens if you try to infringe some of the rules. So all these are detailed in the Indian Telegraph Act. From that, that also Indian Telegraph Act covers telegraph in general. So Indian wireless telegraph rules covers the wireless aspects of the telegraph rules. So what I'll do here is, I'm just giving you a brief, I'll also share the documents, you'll have to go through it on your own. My idea is just to raise your curiosity towards the documents, and so that you read it on your own. So, and most of the questions in the tests also come from very simple things, so probably once you go through it, you'll be able to answer the questions in the exam as well. So coming back, the Indian Wireless Telegraph Rules of 1973 covers the wireless aspects of the Indian Telegraph Act, and it also has made some amendments. So things which are again covered is the same as what happens if you say you're not allowed to listen to the police conversations. What happens if you listen to it, because it's not encrypted. So it says that even though you listen to it, you're not supposed to share with anyone else. And if you share with anyone else, then you're penalized. And what are the penalties, and what are the ways of getting licenses? Then let's come to the next portion, which is the Indian Wireless Telegraphs Amateur Services Rules.
Yeah. Suppose if you are transmitting and by mistake we transmit in their frequency, so what happens?
That's the thing. First of all, you are not supposed to transmit in bands which are not allocated to you. So what they tell you is, in case if you are developing an equipment, the proper way of doing it is to use a dummy load and transmit, so that it doesn't get transmitted. And only once your frequency and all is properly checked, then is the time to actually transmit. So that case should not actually arise. Once in a while, if it happens, it's okay. But the problem happens when someone else goes and complains against it. So there are wireless monitoring stations in each city which can locate your position. They use the RDF equipment and they can try locate you. And the offense punishments are pretty huge. So it's better not to do that. Okay, so the Indian Wireless Telegraph Rules or the Amateur Services Rules, that is an amendment over the Indian Wireless Telegraph Rules of 1973. So what this document talks about is everything that we are going to do. So what are the things that we are allowed to do as a ham? What are the kind of communication that you are allowed to do? So like, first of all, a ham tells you that you are not supposed to use it for any pecuniary interest. Basically means you are not supposed to make money out of the radio services that you are making. And you can't transmit messages on third party's behalf. So you can only transmit your own messages, you can't transmit for someone else. So there are some rules in this aspect about the amateur radio services. So this is what is covered in the Indian Wireless Telegraph Rules. So it even has the syllabus for the exam also as part of the rules. So if you go through this document, it will tell you everything that you have to know about licenses. So in case if you have doubts as to how many years your license is valid, or how do you renew your license, and all this information will be available in this one document. So please go ahead and read it, it's interesting. Okay, now next, let's look at this ITU regulations for amateur radio. So there is this document called radio regulations, which is actually output of this ITU meetings. Okay, International Telecom Union. So what happens is, once in a while they meet and they make amendments, and this is like the constitution for the radio. All across the world, anyone who is using the radio has to abide by these rules and laws. So currently in the syllabus, what we have is the Radio Regulations 2008 edition. Okay, the latest one is 2015 edition. So the syllabus has 2008 edition, and not the entire book, there are like four volumes of the book. So the part of the things which come as part of the syllabus is only the things which are relevant to the amateur services. So for example, you see the designation of emission. So designation of emission in the sense, it tells you how do you designate, say we are saying FM broadcast. So there is a formal way of saying what kind of broadcast it is, which tells you, we'll be going in more detail about this designation of emission sometime. Next is the phonetic alphabets and alpha figure codes. So for example, A, B, C, D, you don't really say that over the radio because it's confusing. So we'll also have a small drill on that today. for 5 minutes. And so it gives you some standard words to use, which is recognized internationally. Then comes the nomenclature and frequency, nomenclature of the frequency wavelength. That most of the people who are with radios already know, like we know VHF, HF. So the names of these frequency bands is also formalized in this document. And like we'll call it a centimeter wave, decimeter wave, millimetric waves, and so on. So each, depending on the wavelength, the names of the band is also defined. So that's what is covered. These are all single page documents in the rules in the document. Most of the documents are just one pages to read. Then comes the frequency allocation for amateur services. So that's something that we need to have it by hearted, because when we are transmitting, we need to know what are the license bands that we are allowed to operate on. So that is to be by hearted. Then interference measures against interference and tests. So how do you, just as sir said, how do you test whether we are interfering with someone else, and what are the rules of how not to interfere, and all comes in this. Then identification of stations. So identification of stations gives you information like what's your call sign, I mean how is the call sign formed, and other information like probably when you're on a ship, what do you do. So now in India as hams we are allowed to carry the mobile, the handset, the radio walkie talkie and go around. So in case my call sign is Victor Uniform to November Foxtrot Kilo or VU to NFK. So the rule says whenever I'm mobile, I have to say add a prefix called Mike Oscar. So I have to tell them I am mobile, MO. So I have to tell them that I am not at home and I am transmitting from somewhere else. So similarly, if I'm on ship and I'm trying to transmit, I should always add MV, which stands for motor vehicle, motorized vessels. So these are the prefixes that I'm supposed to add. So these rules of identification comes in this document.
Is there any geographical boundary?
Yeah, actually we are allowed to transmit within the Indian coast and the international waters, but not into the other countries. I mean, whenever we have a permission to transmit, sometimes we may not even have the permission. So, our license generally gives us the privilege to transmit within the Indian territory only and the open oceans. If you are taking a license, getting the permission to go abroad. But you cannot transmit in other countries' territory unless the country permits you to do it. Then comes distress calls, messages and transmissions. So we all know the SOS call, which is a distress call. So there's a procedure on making the distress call. And if you happen to listen to an SOS call by chance, so what are you supposed to do? So these things are covered in the distress call. And this probably we'll reserve it for the next time. We'll probably can even have drills on training us to answer the SOS calls. So in a way we'll get practice also, and also we can answer the test properly. Then there is an urgency call. So actually we always hear about this SOS calls or the Mayday calls. So apart from that, there are other calls called pan-pan calls. So pan-pan calls are when something is of emergency but not of immediate threat to your life. So there are, and there's one more level of call called Securite. So Securite is a call which is made even at a lesser risk of life. So we need to know when to make which call. So you can't make a SOS call all the time. So if you make a wrong SOS call, that's also a punishable offense. So in this document, you'll know under which circumstances you're supposed to make which call. And you also know how to relay the message forward. If you listen to this message, how are you supposed to relay the message forward? And finally comes the call sign allocation to India. So there is a set of call signs, like we have a VU. So there is actually a range from VT, the aircrafts are all using VT something. So there are blocks of codes which are allocated to each country. So this document will tell you which blocks of codes are allocated to India. Okay, now there is another very interesting thing called the standard frequency and time signal. So if you put on the radio, long before the GPS and the internet time came, we always needed a standard reference for the time. So this is, there is a standard frequency called the standard frequency and time signal. So this operates generally at 2.5 MHz, 5 MHz, 10 MHz, 15 MHz and 20 MHz, all of this in HF. So what happens is the signal is available all across the world. And if you listen to the message, what it will do is for every 1 minute, it will keep continuously keep giving you the time and date of the time and date, and it is synced with a cesium clock. It's very stable and it's used as a reference everywhere.
So these services are even operated even when the GPS and other services are there, because like the ships, the vessels and the aircraft, sometimes when they don't get the GPS signals, they can still get the signal. So these services are still on and will remain to be, will continue to be operational as a backup option, because in case the internet and GPS fails us someday, these services are still there. So actually I feel if someone is interested, they can go through this things that the entire details of this thing and probably give a presentation sometime and make us aware about it, because there are yesterday as I was glancing through, there was a lot of information in it. It's not only date, time, and how do you tell the time, right? So generally what happens is if I say 10 o'clock, what time is 10 o'clock? So the way they do it is, there will be a long beep. So they'll say the time at the end of the beep is 10 o'clock. And they'll start a beep, and the moment it ends the beep, it is exactly 10 o'clock. So there'll obviously be the propagation delays, but it will be more or less accurate within 50 to 100 milliseconds. So that's the maximum delay they say. And even in India, there is one time center, which is being managed by the National Physics Laboratory in Delhi. So if we get an opportunity, we can probably visit that place and see how it operates. So the applications generally are for radio controlled clocks. So there are clocks which are controlled by the radio, which syncs automatically to the time. And for frequency calibration. So when you make your devices and you want to know what frequency you're actually operating on. So if you tune on to a 5 MHz, which is a very stable 5 MHz coming from the HF. So you know that your radio is working properly. So these are the two main applications currently. And then there's something called as the Q codes and abbreviations. So Q codes are actually, this started as part of Morse code. So there were some phrases and sentences which got repeated very often. So people wanted to cut it down and they made short forms for it. And that's called a Q code. So Q codes are, we as amateur radio operators have actually reserved some Q code blocks from QR to QU. These are few of the amateur radio blocks that you're seeing. And this is there for the syllabus, but then there are others also which we generally don't use it. There are also Q codes which are used in aviation. So if you listen to the aviation industry's air band and all, then you'll often hear these Q codes. Say any three-letter combination starting with a Q is a Q code, and it will have a specific meaning. So if you happen to listen to it, just Google on to what the Q code means, and it will tell you. So for the example, assume that I want to ask you, where do you stay? So that's a long sentence to say. So in Morse code, not even in Morse code, these days it's even percolated down to the handies, I mean, even in the oral communication. So generally I'll say, what's your QTH? So QTH stands for where's your home. So I will generally, my reply might be, my QTH is DRDO phase 2, something like that. And the other things which are some of the more commonly used Q codes are like QSL. QSL means confirm. So generally people will ask, will you come there to play with me at 10 o'clock, QSL. So this basically means that I'm asking a question and I'm just asking you to confirm. So the other person, on a reply, if you remove the question mark, it becomes a reply. So he'll say QSL. So that's it. I mean, that's the end of the communication and you're properly, efficiently communicated it. So there is no ambiguity when you're talking in the radio. You have to be as efficient as possible. So these are few of the Q codes. So if you just go through QRA, it's like, what's the name of your station? So this has to be memorized, but it's fun. But the best way of learning it is, probably whenever you're talking, try to use these Q codes and try to respond with these Q codes. So probably I can say QRU. So QRU means, do you have anything for me? I mean, do you have any message for me? So say I'm talking to someone on the phone and probably in a group. And I'll say, in the group, I'll just say, this is me, I'm Bharadwaj, QRU. So this is, it's like asking that I'm in the group, I'm listening to all of you, and do you have anything for me? So then you can say, yes, QRU, then the reply can be, yes, I have something for you. So try to use these Q codes as much as possible. And so a few of the Q codes have also become slangs in amateur radio. So if you listen to the amateur radio communications, you will hear these slangs. For example, they'll say, what's your morning QTH? So morning QTH is your office. So they'll say, where's your morning QTH? So generally they're asking, where do you work? And generally, and another thing that they say often is, I'm QSYing to something. QSY generally says, means changing of frequency. So say you're listening at 14 MHz, you want to change to 14.1. So you'll say, I'm QSYing to 14.1. So that was how it was intended to be. But nowadays they will say, okay, I'm going out. So instead of saying I'm going out, they will say I'm QSYing to market, or I'm QSYing, basically, which means I'm going out, going to some other place. So this is how the Q codes are. And these abbreviations are again from Morse code's world, but the phonetic equivalents are also there. For example, AA, AA generally means all after. So in case you did not hear me properly, so you'll say, please repeat all after some word. So these are all very standard words. So it's not like you don't use random words in radios so that everyone can understand. So you have to use these words so that people can understand you more efficiently. So AB might be like all before. So if you didn't hear something, all before. So you can say word after, word before. So these are all some of the abbreviations which we can use. So the best way to learn all of these abbreviations is to put it in your daily life practice and keep using it. So next comes the, now let's go into some of the details of the ITU radio regulations for amateur radio. So first of all, we'll see the emission standards. Okay, so how do we define the name of ME emission? So emission designation is given by four numbers, followed by another five characters. Okay, the first four specifies the bandwidth. Okay, so for example, if you want to say 2.5 megahertz, so the way to say is, wherever there's a decimal, you have to put a letter. So you will generally say it as 2M50, which basically means 2.5 megahertz. So if you want to say 500 hertz, you will say 500H. So that's the bandwidth designation. Then comes the first letter after that, which is the type of modulation. So we can go to the next slide if you're following around. So it tells what is the kind of modulation that you are going to use in the transmission. So are you using single sideband modulation or FM modulation? So all that designation comes in this. Then the next one is the kind of modulating signal. So is it a digital signal that you are modulating onto the carrier, or you're modulating a voice message, or is it some kind of an image or something like that, or how many channels to the image, and all can be covered in this. Then finally comes the type of transmitted information. So here, this is here where you tell whether it's an oral telephony that you're communicating, whether it's a multimedia, it's a fax, it's a data transmission, and all this comes in this. Then comes the details of information. Okay, then after these first three characters are actually mandatory. The fourth and the fifth characters are optional. So the fourth is generally is a quality specifier as to what kind of quality of your messages. So you can say it's a stereophonic FM modulation. For example, a commercial is a stereophonic FM modulation. So those specifiers are given as the fourth character. And the final character gives you the kind of multiplexing in case if you're doing. So if you're doing a CDMA or a FDMA, you can just use that nomenclature to tell what kind of modulation you're using. So if you look at our frequency allocation chart, it will generally say what kind of modulation. For example, it might say J3E. So they'll say you're permitted J3E. If you just want to see what J3E is, so J means single sideband suppressed carrier. And 3 means one channel containing analog information, and E would mean telephony. So basically in HF communication, whenever you're doing, you're allowed to do J3E, which means you're allowed to do a single sideband transmission with audio message in it, and an analog audio, not digital audio. So and then you also have A3E, in which you can do a double sideband proper AM modulation. So these are all the designations. So whenever you're given a frequency chart now, you can understand as to what your designation is and what all you're licensed for. So that is the reason that you need to memorize it. And more specifically for the exam point of view, it's good to memorize all of it, but they will surely ask you your allocated modes of operation. So you can at least memorize the ones which is allocated for you. And the other ones is good if you memorize. Okay, now let's come to the phonetics. So I just wanted to give a demonstration. I would like to request someone to read out this, spell out this word, and I'll request someone else to copy it, and we'll see how good they are at copying the word. So can someone volunteer to read it out?
Yeah.
each letter?
And it has, you have to just read it out, read out each letter and just do it once. Okay, you're not allowed to repeat it. Okay, but you have to just do it once and then we'll see how good others are copying this.
So, F L O C C I N A U C I N I H I L I P I L I F I C A T I O N.
And one more.
So I'll read the next word. A B P L E.
Okay.
A B P L E.
Okay. And the first one?
That was wrong.
Yes. So actually, the reason why I wanted to do it is. This was without noise, so in case if there was a lot of noise here, it would have been difficult. For example, B and P is confusing. So if I tell you over the phone also, so generally if I say A, B, P, L, E, so there's a chance that you might hear P as B again. So in order to be more efficient, there's a reason that people ask you for giving you the phonetic alphabets. So instead of saying A, P, B, L, E, you can always say Alpha, Papa, Bravo, Lima, Echo. So the advantage is here, at least in India, we are all speaking similarly. So there's a possibility that when you're speaking somewhere abroad, or probably even in India, if you're speaking from a South Indian guy speaking to a North Indian for the first time over the phone, there's a chance that you might miscommunicate under such situations. So for such cases, it is best if you use the telephonic phonetics. So this is not only a requirement, but also a mandate here. So it is not like you can often, you can sometimes use it and sometimes may not use it. But in over the radio, you're always supposed to use it. So there are some standards for the letters as well as the numbers. So the one, instead of saying 1 or 0, they will generally say nada 0. But numbers are more easily distinguishable. So people not bother so much about the numbers. But at least for the letters, it's highly recommended and even mandated that you use the phonetics. Okay, now let's quickly look at the frequency allocation chart. So there is actually a lot of frequencies to memorize, but there is a very good hint to memorize this. Can you look at the frequency charts and tell me what would be the hint? No, it goes other numbers as well. Most of these frequencies have something in common.
Multiples of 10.
No, not multiples of 10. Multiples of 3.5 in fact. So if you see the first one is like, just leave the first one 1.8, but after that you have 3.5. Then leave the next one, which is again you have to memorize anyways. Then you have 7. Then you add 3.5 to it. So approximately it comes to 10 point something. Then plus 3.5 will take you to 14, and plus another 3.5 will take you to 18, and so on, and 21. And the reason why this is so is to make our lives easier. Because when you're putting a HF antenna, when you have the frequency by a multiple, right, so you can always scale the antenna by a multiple. So you can, generally the way the HF antennas are built for ham radios is, there'll be one long dipole, and in between they'll put LC filters. So the filter will act as trap. Okay, so whenever you want a shorter frequency to be received, the closest trap will operate on it automatically. So you'll put different frequency filters at different points and you have one long length of cable. And because it is all similar multiples, it's easy to mark those points.
That band is what?
Frequency, first
column is band, no?
Yeah, so they actually call it as 160 meter band. Depends on the wavelength. So,
capital
receptor. Yeah. So, antennas are going to be very large.
So,
So it will be 1/4 of this.
We have to be lambda by 2, 1/4 of that. So our antenna will have to be that long, but there is also more efficient. There are some antennas which can give up some of the efficiency to get space constraints. So there is a multi-band antenna which is like occupies around this much area and covers all the bands. So for space constrained area, so there are a lot of research happening on this antenna by these hams for this, because they live in apartments nowadays, so they have to make their antenna smaller. So then the next line you can see is there is an emission designation. So it tells you that restricted grade can operate in A3E, S3E, J3E and R3E. Whereas the emission for the general grade is A1A, A2A, A3E. If you see the third A is actually standing for modes. So A1A means that you can do Morse code. So obviously a general grade holder can do Morse code. And that is not there for the restricted grade holder. The general grade holder can also do digital modes, which is not there for the restricted grade holders. And then max power is 50 watts for the restricted grade, and the general grade can transmit 400 watts.
So restricted DC input power.
Basically this is supposed to be the EIRP, but because you are not able to guarantee that, they tell you to restrict to 400 watts of input power. Then the next page gives you the frequency allocation for VHF and UHF. So you see that there is 434, 438. We have all frequencies from 50 MHz to 5.8 GHz. So the higher frequency is on shared basis, so if no one's using, you can use it. Again, 434 to 438 is specifically restricted for SATCOM generally, as an uplink frequency for your SATCOMs. And 144, 146 is your regular VHF, which is used everywhere, here in Bangalore as well as outside, by the hand. 5054 is very uncommon, I have not heard probably many people using it. Okay. So that covers the detailed syllabus today. So this is all that you need to read. So I hope I can't go through all of it properly, but I'll share the documents and put it in a place where you can just download and read it once. Most of it requires just one-time reading. Okay, now let's come to the operating procedures. So this will be interesting. So this is where we will actually be learning how to talk to each other. Okay, so let's say... Okay, now the first thing that we have to remember is in ham radio you are actually broadcasting communication. Okay, you are not speaking one to one. It's not like you are dialing a number or something. So you are actually putting your voice out for everyone to hear. Okay, and so the question is, how will people look for you? How will they know where, how do you contact them? So to start off, what happens is, there will be some frequencies called the call frequencies. So the call frequency is like the telephone number, okay, like whenever you hang up the ringer, you always put it back to the ringer. Same way, whenever you finish talking to the people, you always have to go back to the call frequency. Okay, so anyone who wants to call will call on the call frequency. Okay, so in every band, there is a frequency which is internationally set up as a call frequency. In case, if there is a repeater, like here we have a VHF repeater, three different VHF repeaters, then people generally will not only tag on to the call frequency, but they will also listen to the... repeater frequencies. So instead of being on the call frequency, you can be on the repeater frequency, whichever is convenient for you. Or some people just put it on scan, and the radios have the mode where as soon as an audio comes, it will stop. It will stop scanning. So you can start listening to it. So that's the first thing. So now you know how do you contact people. So at least you should know that there is one frequency where people are all looking for other people. Okay. Now there are different types of calls that you can make. Okay. The first call is the general call. So say I want to call someone, okay. So what will I say is, I just want to talk. I have a lot of free time with me and I just want to see if there is anyone ready to talk with me. So what I will say is, what would be the normal way? I'll say, I am free, is anyone wanting to talk to me? But then that is not the standard way of doing it. The standard way of doing it is to say CQ. Okay, so CQ is a call which is used for a standard call. So the way of communicating it will be, with my call sign, I generally do it like this. I say CQ, CQ, CQ. So these are the three letters which have to be repeated three times. Then you put the word, this is. Okay, so now this CQ and this is not a common word. It is a pro word or a procedural word. Okay, so you say CQ, CQ, CQ. This is Victor Uniform to November Foxtrot Kilo. So I am saying CQ, CQ, CQ. This is Victor Uniform to November Foxtrot Kilo. Okay, and I am allowed to make this call a maximum of 3 times in at a stretch. Okay, so I'll generally say CQ, this is Victor Uniform 2, November Foxtrot Kilo, calling CQ and standing by. So you'll not say an over at the end of it, you'll always say standing by. Okay, so because over is generally to say over to you. Okay, so when you talk, when you start communicating with people, you'll say over, which means over to you. So what we'll do is, after this, we'll have a small drill. We'll just talk to each other, probably just try to talk to each other with the same pro words. So I'll use my name instead initially. So I'll say CQ, this is Bharat calling CQ and standing by. And the pace of this CQ call has to be slow, because if you say it fast, people are, may miss your CQ call. So say it slowly. So one more important thing is, before you make a call, you always have to find out whether the frequency is in use. So the right procedure is, first I will come to the frequency, tune for some time and listen if anyone's transmitting. When no one's transmitting, I'll say, is this frequency in use? So this you ask because there's a chance that those people are talking but they are currently not talking. So you'll say, is this frequency in use? So if they say, you wait for some more time and you repeat it once more. Is this frequency in use? So if no one says anything, then you go ahead and make your call. So you say, CQ, this is Bharat calling CQ and standing by. Some people say CQ calling CQ, this is Bharat calling CQ and standing by. So they call it 3 times and then they just wait for response. Okay, now what happens is, assume that the other person just heard a part of it, he didn't hear the whole part. So the common question is, who's calling? Okay, so the Q code for that is called QRZ. So the other person will generally just come up and say, QRZ, this is, say, we'll just take another name, or say ABC, okay? So I'll say, QRZ, this is VU2ABC, QRZ, this is VU2ABC, so you just say it once. So what happens is, you know that there's a person called VU2ABC who is wanting to talk to you, but he did not catch your call sign. So then the next step is, you'll say, I caught his call sign. So I'll say, Victor Uniform 2, Alpha Bravo Charlie, this is Victor Uniform 2, November Foxtrot. What you do? First you give the call sign of the other person, then you tell this is, and give the call sign of your person, your call sign. Okay, then you start the communication and end it with over. So I'll say, Victor Uniform 2 Alpha Bravo Charlie, this is Victor Uniform 2 November Foxtrot Kilo. Thanks for returning the call. The weather here, probably most of the time they speak about weather to just start up the communication. So I'll say, the weather here is pleasant in Bangalore and the temperature is 20 degree Charlie, which basically is 20 degree centigrade. And it'll say, again, before you end the call, you'll have to say, Victor Uniform 2 Alpha Bravo Charlie, this is Victor Uniform 2 November Foxtrot Kilo, over. And why you make the final call is, when you say VU2ABC, this is VU2NFK, you want only that person to reply, you don't want anyone else to reply. Okay, so once you start a communication, the other person is not going to come in between. So the other person will, now he will start, he'll say, Victor Uniform 2 November Foxtrot Kilo, this is Victor Uniform 2 Alpha Bravo Charlie. He sends this message, again ends the same way. If he wants me to talk, he'll say, Victor Uniform 2 November Foxtrot Kilo, this is Victor Uniform 2 Alpha Bravo Charlie, over. So the first thing to learn is, first wait for the freeze channel, ask whether the channel is free, then call the CQ, and whenever you call the CQ, you give your call sign. Don't irritate people by making too many CQ calls, so just make 3 CQ calls, and in between CQ calls, give a gap of 30 seconds. And then if they don't respond in 3 CQ calls, most probably they don't either want to talk to you or they are not in the band. Okay, so it's better not to try immediately again. And the way to end your conversation is to say over. Okay, so the first pro word that you learned today is over. So over basically means over to you. This is used only when you're talking to someone else. Now, there's another pro word called out. Okay, and we have heard people say over and out. Now, over and out does not happen. Okay, over means over to you. Out means, out is used when I have finished my transmission and I'm not interested to listen to more of yours. Okay, so you'll generally say he has relayed your message. So the end of the communication generally happens like this. So the normal procedure is to say thank you for that contact. Okay, so the way to say it is, say VU2ABC is telling. So you'll say VU2ABC, this is Victor Uniform to, the other way, it's VU2NFK, this is VU2ABC. Thanks for the call, or thanks for the QSO. QSO is the Q code for the contact. So you say thanks for the QSO, hope to catch you soon. and then generally they'll end it with a code called 73. So 73 comes from the telegraph phase, where 73 stands for good wishes. So you say best wishes or best regards. So you generally say 73, bye-bye, and listening. Generally the other person says listening for your finals. So listening for your finals means that I have finished transmitting mine. I'll listen for just one more over after this. So you say listening for your finals. This is VU to ABC. VU to ABC, this is VU to NFC, or the other way around. So I generally put my call sign back because I'm used to that. So when I finish my call, I say VU to NFK, this is VU to ABC, this is VU to NFK. Thanks for the call, 73, bye-bye. Then again, I'll say VU to ABC, this is VU to NFK, out. So out means I'm done. Okay, I don't want ABC to again reply. Okay, sometimes I might say out and standing by for other stations. So if I want to talk to other stations, I'll say out and listening to other stations. But I'm done with that person. So that's the reason that over and out will never go together. Okay. And now say that me and another person is already talking and someone wants to come in. So what's the right way of interfering? So interference might generally happen, say, if I'm talking about some game, say badminton, and someone else is interested in badminton and he wants to join in. So he will say, he wants to discuss something. So the way to do it is, when I finish communicating and before the other person starts communicating, he will put his call sign in between. Okay. For example, if your call sign is VU to KPL, okay. So I'm talking to VU to ABC. So in between, you'll say, just as soon as I say over, you'll say VU to KPL. Okay. So now what happens is, because I had finished talking, the other person is already listening. So he would have heard your call sign. So if he's interested, he might pull you in. If he's not interested, he just ignores you. Okay. If he ignores you, you get another opportunity when he finishes talking. So I might put you in. So you will finish talking and then again you will say VU to KPL and I might put you in. Okay, so that's the procedure. And sometimes even if I want to pull you in, I will say VU to KPL, please stand by, I will pull you in. Okay, so which means that don't come now, just wait for a few seconds, I will finish talking and then call you. So that's the standard way of talking. And when three people form a group, now I, KPL and ABC have formed a group. So end of the thing, I will say VU to, like earlier I was saying VU to ABC, this is VU to NFK, to say that ABC has to talk next. But now I'll maintain a chart, I'll maintain a round robin chart. So I will say VU to KPL, this is VU to NFK. So I'm saying that the next person to talk is KPL. Now when KPL finishes, he'll hand over the mic to ABC. So that's how the round robin happens. And in between, and there is another case where you want to break in as an emergency. So this was a regular break in when it's not an emergency. But say it's an emergency and you are occupying the channel and it has to be communicated, you'll come in with a break. You'll not say anything, you just say break. So breaks have to be acknowledged. So whenever it's a break, generally the person will say breaker come in. Okay, so the breaker is the person who wants to break in. So breakers are always given priority and he has to have a useful message, otherwise there's no point of breaking in. So whenever you're breaking in, just be sure that it is a message which cannot wait. Okay, and otherwise if you just want to join the conversation, just give your call sign out. Okay, so this is the normal CQ call. You want to practice once? You can make a small, just try a three-way communication. Okay, I'll start the call and one of you can reply. So for now, we can just use the, say the other call sign is ABC. So I'll say, CQ, 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 this is Victor Uniform to November 4th dot kilo calling CQ and standing by. Someone has to respond. you can just try, you can just go ahead. So, one of you can say, you can say Victor Uniform 2, November Foxtrot Tito, this is Victor Uniform 2, Alpha Bravo Charlie. Someone can say that. Actually, this mic shyness is something which actually the ham radio takes it away. Because once you're on the radio, you're anyways broadcasting to everyone. So the mic shyness goes away. Okay, anyways. If you're feeling shy currently, you can probably use the app and go at home, you can try it. So, Zello. So what you've done is in the app, you have a community there, one group there. So we can all be logged in there. And whenever we're talking, we can follow all these procedures and try to talk with each other. Okay, now the next call is the DX call. So DX call is done when I want to talk to a distance station but not a local station. So when I'm talking on HF, and if I don't want to speak to anyone on India,
I just want to speak to come to the end of it. Yeah, and one more thing is the RST system. This will be asked. So, when, like, the question is, what do you communicate with other people, right? How do you even start a communication? So, whether you do anything else or not, whatever you talk about, whether you talk about your hobbies or anything else, the one thing which is surely communicated when you're talking on Morse or with anybody else in other station is the RST. Okay. Now, RST stands for readability, signal strength, and tone. Okay. So, whenever I talk to another station abroad, I'll tell him, the first thing that he tells me is, what is the quality of your signal? Okay. So, and the way to specify is, it is given as a grading from 5, 9 and 9. Okay. With the higher number being better. Okay. So, if the readability is perfect, he will say, if readability is good, signal strength is good, and tonal quality is given only when you're using Morse code. So, if the, if your tone, the generator of the tone is very nice, then you have a very good tonal quality, otherwise it spreads. So you just listen to it and you'll say your tone, your signal is coming as 599. So 599 means you are having a very good readability, very good signal strength, and a very good tone. So with this you can actually estimate how far your signal is going and how your radio is operating. So this is something that you need to memorize. There is 1 to 5 some numbers is there, and each number means something, like how good your readability is. But when you're doing an audio communication, you'll not talk about tone. So it's very bad to talk about someone's tone. So you generally talk about the readability and the signal strength. So you generally say, you're coming 5.9 to me. So you say, how do you read me? You say, I'm reading you 5.9. 5.9 means I'm reading you very good and the signal strength is also good. So it's possible that I am very far away from the repeater and I'm getting 5.3. So I'll say, I'm reading you 5.3. So I can still hear you very clearly, understand you properly, but the signal strength is only 3. Okay. So that is the RST system, and some people also add one specifier after this, which tells you whether there is any extra noise. For example, they will add K. K means there is click sound. So whenever you are leaving the Morse code, you might get a click sound extra. So that's interfering. And so normal reports generally goes like this. The normal report will be, I read you 5.9 over an audio communication. I'll say I read you 5.9 with a little bit of QRM. QRM means mixing. So if there is another station talking with around the same frequency, I'll say I'm reading you with a very good quality, but there is some amount of mixing. So I'll say I'm reading you 5.9 with QRM. Or if I say there is a lot of QRN, so there is a lot of noise, thermal noise behind you, static generator. So I'll say I'm reading you 4.5 with QRN. It basically means that I'm able to understand you, not as good as I want to, and the signal strength is slightly weaker, and there is a lot of static behind. So you know how the propagation condition is. So this is about today's topic. So what we have covered today is, we have covered the syllabus explanation, we have seen what all to be studied, and we have covered a part of the procedures, not the complete one, because the other part is the distress calls, which we can probably meet some other time and do it, and or you can just suggest how do you want to do it now. And we have covered, so if you, the things to be memorized is, there is a table where I have given all the appendices and this thing, right? In the fourth or the fifth slide, I mentioned as to which topic is available in the which radio regulations part. So that is only the thing to be memorized, but most of the things you can just glance through and you can pass this exam. So the first thing is, please don't fear about the exam is easy to pass, and it's generally fun, it's more of such kind of activities only, and it's useful also because you need it finally to use the equipment. So that's about today's talk. Actually, we are going to submit the form tomorrow. So I hope it might be in November at the earliest if you try. But
duration.
Okay. The duration is 1 hour.
So it's online or we have to go to
function? No, they will come here and conduct it. Because we are more in number, so we can request them to come.
They'll come to our place.
Yeah. This is going in the YouTube. I thank all the old men here for being here.